Hello, Dr. Joe here of the DocsJoe.com and the 2020forum.com. In today's video, I just want to show some clips from my 2021 series. Now, obviously, I published 52 videos the whole of 2021, and I cannot take clips from all the 52 videos because if I did that, we'll be here till the cows come home, and we don't want to do that. So I've just taking some clips from about, you know, 5 or 6 videos or so, and to just demonstrate things that you can do to improve your health. So the first video you're going to see now, or the first clip you're going to see now, is a video where I was talking about how we can use soups for weight management. And in that video, I was also demonstrating a soup maker, because the easiest way to make soups is to have a soup maker. Anyway, here's the clip. If you love your soups, and you should, because soups are a great way to manage your weight. Mainly because a lot of the ingredients we use for soup making are low energy ingredients, okay? Usually vegetables, and those are energy light ingredients. And the end result is that your soup is usually an energy light food. An energy light finished product. What a better way to manage your weight. Okay. So to use the machine, the soup maker, take out the cover there, which is the sub unit that does the heavy lifting. So we're just gonna add our tomato in here. So you just pour from the container. As you can see, it's nice and smooth. Nice and smooth. There you go. Soup is here. It's ready. And it's time for us to taste the finished product. Okay, so let's go. Still quite hot, actually. I tell you what. This is really so good. It's always difficult to stop me. And so on a cold February morning, I decided to go out there and start off a 30-day challenge, because February is traditionally Heart Health Month. So I started off the 30-day challenge, and here's what I said. So what you're gonna get in this video? Well, I'm gonna give you 4 tips for the prevention of heart attacks and also for improvement of heart health. 4 nice tips. And I want you to pay attention to tip number 4. Tip number 4 is where the challenge lies, okay? Tip number 4 is where the 30-day challenge lies. Now, here's the other thing. It doesn't matter what month of the year you watch this video. Your 30-day challenge begins the day you watch this video. That's the way I want you to take this video forward. So 4 tips for you and a 30-day challenge for you. So let's get started. Tip number 1. Now, I didn't want to go into the exercises that I suggested, because we might be doing that again this year. So anyway, next I talked about anxiety and a concept that I call combination therapy for anxiety using herbal teas. So here is a demonstration that I did for combination therapy for anxiety. We are going to be doing combination therapy. How does it work? Well, let me just give you a quick demo of how combination tea therapy actually works. So all you just need to do is get the teas. Okay, so this is the lavender tea. I'm just going to chuck one bag in there, in the bag, in the teacup rather. And then you get the lemon balm. Here we go. Take one, chuck one tea bag into the tea mug. What else? We've got the Tulsa basil tea. So we're just gonna rip it open. And chuck the tea in the tea mug as well. And then just add boiled water.
and we are going to let that steep for at least 10 minutes, okay? At least 10 minutes. Let it steep. We want to get all the active ingredients into the water, and then we're going to drink the tea and then see what happens. So 10 minutes later, what do? We pick up our tea mug, our cup of tea, and then we drink the tea as usual. What you are going to get is a riot of flavors, but that's okay. What we want to do is maximize the benefits of the active ingredients in the three different types of tea we've got inside this teacup. Okay.
Let me just I went on to talk about the concept of whole foods and what it actually means, because a lot of people do not really understand what whole foods mean. So I did a video where I lined up foods in three lanes. So lane one was whole foods, lane two was minimally processed foods, and then lane three was the heavily processed version of that whole food. So here is how it went. Let me just define what whole foods is, so that you can put it into context. Well, whole food is a food that is unaltered. It is in its natural state. And that's one aspect of the definition of whole foods. The next aspect of the definition is that nothing bad has been added to that food, okay? And usually we're talking about salt, sugar, and fat being added to the food. So nothing bad has been added. And the third aspect of the definition of whole food is that nothing good has been stripped away from that food, okay? So the food is unaltered. Nothing bad has been added, and nothing good has been taken away from the food. When you have that, that constitutes whole food. So, with that in mind, let's get started. So, what I have here, I've got three lanes of foods here, okay? So, you got lane one, okay? Lane one constitute whole foods. Lane two constitute minimally processed version of the whole food on lane one, and lane three is the heavily processed version of the whole food on lane one. So lane one, whole food, lane two, minimally processed, and lane three, heavily processed. Okay, so let's start with classic example. So this is rice, okay? This is brown rice. This is brown basmati rice. This is whole food, because it contains the entire grain. Now, in lane two, for rice, we've got white rice, okay? So you got white rice here. So this is minimally processed version of the brown rice. In lane three, we've got Rice Krispies, okay? This is heavily processed version of the rice. Next, I upset a whole establishment because I did a video on honey, and I talked about a randomized control trial that showed that honey was just as inflammatory a food as high fructose corn syrup and table sugar. So here's what I said. So let's look at this. It was published in the Journal of Nutrition, and it's titled "Consumption of Honey, Sucrose, and High Fructose Corn Syrup Produces Similar Metabolic Effects in Glucose Tolerant and Intolerant Individuals." Okay, what the researchers were looking for was the effect of these three sweeteners, high fructose corn syrup, honey, and sugar, the effect on glucose, insulin, lipids, inflammatory markers, and body weight. Those were the outcome measures they were looking out for. So let's look at the study result. So the study result goes like this, and this is quite interesting. What they found was that all three sweeteners raised blood sugar. All three sweeteners raised insulin levels. Yes. All three sweeteners produced insulin resistance. Okay. All three sweeteners raised inflammatory markers. And all three sweeteners raised blood triglycerides. The only difference was the fact that we had, or rather they had, higher responses in the pre-diabetic individuals more than the people who did not have any glucose issues. Okay, so the point being made there in that study is that in terms of metabolic markers, there is no difference between honey and sugar. No difference. They're both essentially the same. They do the same thing. They have the same effects on your metabolic markers. After all, that is what we're interested in. We want to know whether honey is safer than sugar. And as far as that randomized control trial is concerned, there isn't any difference.
This is obviously that video did upset the honey faithfuls, but it was a revelation for a lot of people. And you know, at the end of the day, facts are facts, and so shall it be. Next, I talked about my plan for tackling pre-diabetes and type 2 diabetes. And here's what I said.
This is my approach under that plan. So I call it here Dr. Joe's approach. So you want to stay off starchy foods in the beginning, okay? Because in the beginning, you're still very much insulin resistant. So you want to avoid the really starchy foods because they're going to send your blood sugar high, and it's best to avoid them in the beginning. We will reintroduce them later on, but at the start, it's best to avoid them. Next in my plan is that you can have eggs, you can have fish, and you can have yogurt, okay? And I'm talking about natural yogurt or Greek yogurt, okay? Not the sugary ones. What else? You can have lots of vegetables. Lots, all right? Lots of vegetables. Next is that you can have peas, beans, and lentils. So those are legumes, generally speaking. Here we go, here. I've got peas here. These are garden peas or green peas. I ate lots of these when I started my journey, and I still do anyway. I used my garden peas as a substitute for white rice, because I used to eat lots of white rice before I became pre-diabetic. Now I don't. And that was a very good substitute for me. I also had lots of these chickpeas, okay? Lots of that, I still do. And black-eyed peas as well, all right? So yeah, legumes, they are the way to go. They're a nice substitute for the starchy foods, because in those, you've got lots of resistant starch. Okay, let's move on. Under my plan, you want to avoid saturated fat. We can argue this until the cows come home, but we do know there's research evidence to support the view that saturated fat makes your insulin resistance worse, so best avoid it. Next is that because we're avoiding saturated fat, you can have healthy fats. These are the unsaturated fats. So, you know, fats from nuts, seeds, and avocados, good for you. Next, we also want to cut down on vegetable oils, okay? We don't want to stop using vegetable oils altogether, but we want to reduce how much of it we use over time. Cut down. When I see people prepare something like hummus and they drip a whole bottle of olive oil on it, I just think, for heaven's sake, you don't need all of that. So cut down on your vegetable oils, and you'll be helping your pre-diabetes and your type 2 diabetes. Next is, I put here, we want to reverse our insulin resistance, and there are ways around this. I'm going to do a separate video on that. All of these steps will help reverse your insulin resistance, by the way, but there's one other thing that you need to do that is very, very important when it comes to reversing your insulin resistance. So that's that. Next is, like I said, I'll do a separate video on that. Next, I put here, this one is related to diet. I know this video was mainly about diet, but I felt I needed to include this here. And I'm referring to intermittent fasting. So obviously those are just clips from a couple of the videos from last year. There were 52 videos, and I cannot take clips from all of them. Hopefully, I will be able to do another 52 videos this year, and we'll see how things turn out. And like I said in the last video, a second channel is going to be popping up where I'll be talking about high blood pressure and cardiovascular matters. So be on the lookout for the second channel. You can leave your comments down below. I think that's about it for today's video. Until next time, well, this is Dr. Joe signing out.